was the stage manager for Cadillac Crew, which was written by the lovely Tori Sampson, and it was directed by the wonderful, super talented James. So glad to be joined on this stage with such lovely, talented, multifaceted artists, especially for Women's History Month. I think it's important that we really take this time to collect ourselves and understand all the themes that we talked about throughout the show, right? Feminism, grassroots strategizing, community organizing, and one of the most important that our writer declared a civil rights issue, not only within the show, but even just in general, which is anti-rape activism. Mm-hmm. Super important, especially as it relates to the female demographic for this particular month. So I say all that to say, I have a few questions for the cast and for our director, and then I'm gonna open it up for you all to ask us questions as well. So first off, I want to start with our director, Enzo. Talk to us a little bit about what attracted you to Cadillac Crew and wanting to showcase it to an audience.
Oh yeah. So I was lucky enough to be invited to lovely Vermont last fall, where Ashley and Ange were originally in the cast of the show, of the production, and I got to see it for the first time, and it was great. It was great. And I also got to see the reading that they did before in a different part, or in Jersey, somewhere else.
Jersey City.
Okay, different part. At JCTC, and phenomenal. So I was already attracted to the play in and of itself, in a context where I love me all femme cast. Like, give me that any day. Give me a play that focuses on like POC issues and things that are still prevalent now. And I think there's that's like the biggest thing that attracted me, is that like that last line in the play is like that I wish I knew. It's just, it resonates so much to a point where I guess it's like an addiction to a knowledge and wanting to consume more to know more. And the more you learn, the more you know you don't know a damn thing. And so for me, all of those sort of intersections and angles culminate into a great piece to kind of dissect. And there are pieces of that in every scene. So that was really interesting for me, for sure.
I love that. I'm gonna open this question up to the rest of the cast, and whether you are female identifying or any of the other, in embracing some of these characters, what did this production grow for you in your womanhood or your humanity, or what did it help you heal from?
Wow, that's a nice question.
Great question, Aja.
Thank you.
That was heavy. No, what?
You started speaking. Damn.
I would love to hear your perspective first. No. The only reason why I say that is because I want to hear what Dee thinks. Because we went through it in Vermont. Mm-hmm. So, like, I know. But I want to hear what you first. I'm going to throw to you first.
I guess what a challenge for me, in general, is just the lack of knowledge that I know about these very prominent women. I grew up in a family that really preached and ingrained in me a sense of like Black history and Black pride and pride in being a woman and being myself. But I'm realizing, at least for me and maybe others in my generation, that we think there's been so much change and progress that we've not, but that we've not really decided to look at the reasons why there have been and the people that have helped us get to where we are today. And I think in doing this play, it made me realize that I do need to go back and really make sure that I'm paying homage to people that have made it, done it, so that we're able to be here today and sit and do these plays and sit and be able to pursue a career in acting in general, you know what I mean?
I appreciate your honesty and transparency and even admitting the introduction to some of these stories, because I think often we hear about these large concepts as it relates to social justice or feminism, and there are still new stories that are needed to be told to certain audiences. And so, to piggyback off of that, with the various issues that women are facing today, such as, I think you're here in particular, mentioning
state-sanctioned violence, right? Which is on the uprise and increase specifically for women today, along with girls and the trans community. And we can't forget the pay disparities that we experience that still hasn't been fixed within this country. And one of the number one hot topics that's in mainstream, the attack on our reproductive rights. So I just lay all this out to ask for anybody on the panel here, how do we take what we experience from your performance in Cadillac Crew to implement it in real time in our communities, wherever we're all traveled in from? What can we learn from Cadillac Crew to put it in real time? Action.
I think for me, one of the biggest takeaways that I've had in terms of just, and I'll try to say this as quickly as possible, is that misogyny is so normalized that sometimes even in our language, we can dehumanize. And I've learned it myself because with slang and AAVE, it's like whores or sluts or any other, you know, derogatory words, right? But the way and the gender connotations of certain words and the way in which we speak about people, even people we love, you know, we have to be able to kind of articulate our language better and like reflect that around the people that we're in community and space with in a loving way. But there also has to be a boundary. Like, I really don't want to hear like my guy friends talking about whoever, but in a derogatory way, even if it's just a throwaway. It's not a throwaway. Words get people killed. And it's not words that kill people, but it's the thinking, the rhetoric that comes up multiple times. It's the rhetoric behind a certain notion of dehumanization that has to be dismantled. And even if it's just like, okay, well, I mean, if bitches comes out sometimes, and I don't want to say that. It's like, the work is that correction. The work is no longer spewing out that harm in a way that affects a woman's gendered body more than it will affect someone who is not gendered in that way, right? Because it's race and gender is put on to.
Yeah.
It's not something that's and then inside out. It's very much thrown onto our bodies. So I find it rejecting all those social ideals and things that we put onto our body and even wear it as pride, right? Like blackness, being called black once upon a time was not cool. It was do not call me black. Now it's black. It's a reclamation, which is different than like the N word before, the R, you know? So we have to be in community and space in discourse about this in a critical way. Even when we're enjoying and at a social event, slide it in there because it's love. It's love. It's love.
For sure. I love that because in 2024 especially, what it all boils down to is think before you speak. Mm-hmm. Because the definitions or how we define oneself are such an open window now, and there are new generations that are fostering to where they not only are reclaiming but affirming what they define for themselves and being authentic, and any and everyone should be respected of that. Mm-hmm. So we should all think before we speak a little bit more. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that answer. My final one that I'm gonna ask before I open it up to the rest of you, I think it's important to highlight that one of our actors here on the stage played a dual role in bringing this production to light. Right, and I'm talking about the character that played Rachel, is known as Ashley. She not only played Rachel, but she was also the executive producer of this show. And so, my question is geared towards you. With the current budget cuts that we're experiencing, specifically in art programs, in public schools, after school programs, and even just within communities at large.
Yeah.
Why is it so important to keep accessibility to theater or the arts in spaces like this?
Well, I mean, accessibility, okay? So accessibility could be bringing it to an area that wouldn't normally get theater, a story like this, where people have a chance to see themselves. That does change a person. We have children that are in the audience. We have some young kids. Where's these kids looking around like, who? I'm talking about you. He's like, who? Yes, you. But being able, the beauty of being able to see yourself reflected and your see that your stories matter, I think that is a huge game changer for a lot of kids. And then just being able to bring it to a community where you're hearing something that is so vital. This play does give actionable things that people can actually do, especially in terms of like voting and how we advocate for each other, advocate for ourselves, and also like creating community and organizing. You know, how can we do that within our own communities? So I'm an actor, producer, director, and educator. So I work in a lot of different facets. And yeah, like, I mean, Miss Mary, you guys, some people here know Miss Mary. She's like 84, older black woman who's been, does like jazz, but also teaches in the schools and stuff like that, theater and drama. So for me, she's been like a mentor to me, helping me learn, you know, how to do what she does and everything. She taught me sign language to say, how are you? But as a song, how are you? Fine, thank you. How are you? Fine, thank you. How are you today? So you learn how to say that in sign language. And so I'm working right now with small children. Some kids are verbal, some are verbal, some are nonverbal. For the first time, some of the teachers have heard their kids, one child specifically, speak for the first time. He usually just grunts or goes like, or something, but he's like, how are you? He's doing it real slow, but that's the first time they've heard him say words, you know? And so we got a grant. I work with Newark School of the Arts, where I teach music and movement. And so I was doing that with these small kids. The age I teach is like 7 months to 3 years old, but I'm seeing that they're becoming more verbal now, and they're learning through music, through the songs I'm teaching, through the sign language that Miss Mary taught me that I wouldn't normally get if I didn't know this woman. Helped me be able to give a child another way to communicate through the arts. I would not be there if I didn't have a grant to put me in that space. Otherwise, they would just be like, I don't know, this kid doesn't speak, I don't know what to do with them. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So you need to make it accessible. It's very important. That can give a child language.
I love that.
You know?
Definitely. Yeah. It sounds a lot about art being a healing tool.
Yeah.
Art being an enlightenment tool. And also our elders being able to instill within us to be able to pass the torch to the next generation. So
absolutely.
Let's give a round of applause for Ms. Mary for even doing that.
Yeah!
I get a kick out of these conversations. I love it. I want to hear from you all. We want to hear from you all. If anyone has a question, please feel free. Let us know your name and let us know your question.
Hi, Evan. My name's Trenda. And, you know, I was just sitting here like mesmerized. I mean, even now, like, I'm like this. Just sitting here mesmerized because it's so easy to take things for granted.
Yeah.
Okay, and I have to confess, I mean, like, there are four women on my block I could have invited over here today. Mm-hmm. I didn't even think about it, you know? And that's not to my credit, okay? They're supposed to be friends. They're supposed to be people I care about. They certainly would have enjoyed it as much as I did. I didn't even think about it. So, I was just sitting here thinking of things I could do better to even let people know what's going on at the cultural center, even on my blog.
Yeah.
You know, get more engagement, you know what's going on and everything like that. But specifically, especially to you, because you are an executive producer, so I'm sure you know everything that goes into the ad, especially the money.
Yeah.
How do you scale this? Because it's like it's a performance, but it's an in-person performance. Do you turn it into a movie? I mean, how do you scale it so more people can see it faster?
Do this in like over and over again at different
like
places?
Over and over again. I don't know. Turn it into a movie or series. I don't know. I don't know any of the mechanics of that. But have you ever thought about scaling it so that more people can see it?
Well, I mean, that's where the funding. You know, that's a funding thing as far as like people having a budget to like, you know, put in. I think it's best received as like a full production personally.
Okay.
This is a stage reading. So if you like the stage reading, you can only imagine what that would be like. If we don't have the books in hand, you know, we have our full on costume made up as our characters, and then we change the podcast and all that stuff. Like, it's a very interesting switch, you know, from like 1963 to 2020, that quick, you know. And so, but I think, you know, I think it would be, there's a lot of contracts that, even for this, we'd like to do so many contracts. to get approval to do this year, you know, yeah. And so that would be another thing. There's just a lot of moving parts, people, help, assistance, you know, it's hard for like, right now Sam also is my partner working with me on this, as also executive producer too, you know, on the project. So we, you know, it was us kind of working together, trying to get it together, but there's more people, we need more help and more funding.
I wanted to add on to that. As someone who also, in addition to being an artist, I'm a community development consultant specializing in economic development, right? Mm-hmm. And making sure that the arts is super accessible. Mm-hmm. So to your story of even partnering with Sam here at this library, it all starts with talking to people.
Yeah.
Right? Because that partnership happened through conversation.
That's true.
And
that's
so true. Even though you weren't able to invite your neighbors around, you go back and have a conversation with them in passing. I can't believe what I saw. Y'all have to see it. And you never know who you're talking to, right? You never know who's walking around you that is an artist,
right?
That just works within corporate.
Right.
So the first step is definitely spreading the word, word of mouth, because we also have to get back to that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great question.
Thank you.
Does anybody else have one?
Thank you.
Let's know your name.
One of the things that I love so much about this piece was it crammed so much in without it getting muddy and confusing. Mm. The thing that I want to talk about is the ancestral piece, these people that went before us and like paved the way and remembering them and their names. Mm. Ashley knows, I know Ashley, and I'm an actor.
And a playwright.
All the things, that's how we do. But especially for the actors, but for everybody up here, it's a lot of times we draw from those people,
right.
that we know. Mm-hmm. And the beauty of recalling those people. So I'm wondering, anyone who would like to share, who were the ancestors, the people that came before you, you know, alive or dead, that you called on to be able to come into this space and embody these characters so beautifully?
So I did this piece in Vermont, mm-hmm. the original cast, and we had the costumes, lights, the whole fixing. But I never, I guess, called on anyone. I would say what I did was I would have like people like the Supremes in my head or on my vision board or something like that. So I guess in a way that would be calling them into this space to like embody Abigail. But for this time around, this was the first time that I actually got to call upon someone who now I view as an angel. Her name is actually Abigail.
Come on.
And so it hit me today. I was like, oh wow. My Aunt Abigail just transcended recently. And so I felt like calling her character into this and realizing that the story can change, right? The story of Vermont was not the same story that I said today, but it was a story that you all received that now it hits in so many ways. We were always like developing and understanding our characters way more. And so the things that we say land differently. And so I would say this time around, I was call upon them, calling upon Ruby D. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Ruby D graced these very same stage.
That's
so
right.
It's like that in itself, but yeah, those are some people that I would have said called upon.
Yeah. I mean, when I was working on the production, I was like using Dr. Dorothy Hyde a lot because I liked what she had to say. I liked the stuff she stood for, and I liked just her energy. Like, I felt like I could feel that felt like, you know, Rachel to me, you know, because I could be like really goofy and like saying something like, so like, how is that, how do I, you know, like just kind of focus that a little bit so that I am this person and I am in this world, you know? So Dr. Dorothy Hyde was someone that I would use, Daisy Bates, and then I also used Miss Mary too. Like for today, I was like dedicating the thing to her because she has this nice grounding energy. Like she's really sweet and stuff, but she's also could be very just grounded. So I sometimes channel her to like keep me, even if I'm like nervous or something, I can go like, I'm like, oh, I just miss Mary, you know, bring it in, because she has such elegance and regalness to her, so pull that in.
That was a great question.
The Coretta Scott King moment in the play, I thought was brilliant, you know, when she giving piece of her mind to her husband behind the scenes, that cracked me up. Like, when you guys talked about that, how did that formulate? Do you find it changing if you do it again? Would you add a little bit more to it? I mean, I'm just curious.
Do you, like, dialogue-wise, or, like, what part exactly are you talking about?
yours truly up there has got to be saying, said, I don't need a backup singer.
Oh, they're singing.
Yeah.
Part.
Oh,
okay. That was so great. I think that was a great moment that the playwright really gave us a different perspective of Coretta, because some people, me included, when I read this in Vermont, I didn't know Coretta could sing. Mm-hmm. I knew, but I just didn't know to that extent. And so when they compare her to, like, the Supremes and the Skydets, it was just like, oh, wow. That's going to be a fun little moment to pretend what it would have been like to see Coretta had we known Coretta's story and had we seen her in the forefront. Instead, like the play alludes, if she, you know, she was like a wallflower kind of, she led from behind. And so with that moment, I feel like every single time I get to learn, and going back to the original question that you asked, what did this play help you learn? Helps you learn how to own space. Without it being ego-driven and without you being afraid to take up too much space. Mm-hmm. So I feel like we can't add word-wise, but energy-wise, I guess it would just be a full-fledged moment. Like if we had like a budget and a wardrobe, it's a quick change into something. I guess that's what I would add, but yeah, that moment is brilliant.
It was great here, and it was also great in the show. It's like, that's such a wonderful moment that the playwright lends for the actors, so the audience can kind of just breathe and like take it in, you know, because you're about to get hit real hard soon by the death of these women on the radio, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's a nice little reprieve, you know.
And it adds to the juxtaposition of those scenes. Like, in that moment, like being on the road and being in these dangerous situations, you can always be laughing, but then at the drop of a hat, life will never fail to remind you who's in charge, or
the reality
of the situation. Yeah, you can be smiling, but then you realize, oh, your friends could be shot and killed and burned on the side of the road in the blink of an eye. So it just reminds you of the time and what they survived and what they sacrificed for us.
Yeah. Ooh, that's a lot. No, it was good. Because I'm compelled to say, like, even from a historical standpoint, that that was the beauty of Negro spirituals, right? When our people were enslaved within plantations and cotton fields, and they would talk to each other in code in that way through Negro spirituals, but it's something about being a part of the diaspora, the Black diaspora in particular, what music does for us. And so when you taking the space on stage as just an audience member watching that, along with the Scottettes, it was a healing moment before the pain was about to come, and that's something that we've always used, and still to this day.
Yeah.
That's why some of our favorite musicians hit us in certain ways that we can't describe because only music can. Mm-hmm. So that was an amazing question.
Thank you.
All right, I got a two-part question. And my question is that where y'all go from here? I mean, you all just did a reading, but what's next? What's the big for Danza? I mean, we had a whole Cadillac show like we did in Beaumont.
Yeah, I would love to do Cadillac Crew here, like in Jersey City. You know what I mean? Like, if we had a budget for it, just to do it, you know, here. I think that'd be so cool. Or get it on Broadway.
Yeah.
Because that still hasn't been on Broadway yet. Like, if we could bring it, like, get it.
Yeah.
This would be a great show.
We would have to contact the playwright, Tori Sampson.
Yeah.
But I think this could be on Broadway.
This could totally be on Broadway.
Today. You know
what
I'm saying?
That would be amazing. I think it's a newer play. I love it because it's not, you know, we have the same, which I love August Wilson, you know, I love Lorraine here, it's very old stuff. But it's nice when you can have something like a newer, fresher piece that is like talking to what's happening right now, but still calls on the past, but then also brings us back to like what's happening right now as well. So, but I would love to like do it on Broadway.
Yeah.
And that would be great. But also just to say, it always goes back to funding.
To get started, you should contact Olga Levina from the Jersey City Theater
That's
Center.
Where I work at.
Good.
Yeah, that's where we did the first reading, was Jersey City.
Oh, good.
Theater Center.
Good.
She's very aware of the show.
Good.
Oh, yes, my name is Jerome. I like the fact that, you know, sometimes when we hear about the Civil Rights Movement and the people that in the Civil Rights Movement, we almost think of them as superheroes. Mm-hmm. And what I loved about the characters here, that you brought them to life and made them seem more accessible.
Yeah.
That you knew that they had their doubts and they had their problems and they put them aside to do something courageous. And you know, Martin Luther King said, Everyone can be great because everyone can serve. Mm-hmm. And that's what I got from this play, is that y'all were just ordinary women who had a lot of insecurities and doubts. But y'all knew what y'all had to do, not only for yourself, but for your children and for the future. And you know, and that I love about that. Because you know what you threw out from your heart came back to me.
Kind of thinking about how far we've come, that you kind of almost forget that it took such an effort to get to where we are today. We also know that we're living in a time where democracy is under attack.
Yeah.
What do you think, considering the pioneers of the civil rights movement, the pioneers of yesterday till today, what more can we be doing? What more should we be focusing on and thinking about?
So without being like too divisive with everyone's thoughts and opinions going on right now, what I would say is like, see what you can do more of. And if you're not in community, or if you're in spaces that are perhaps more white-led, or more male-led, or more cis-led, perhaps that's not the ideal radical framework that we're working from in terms of systems of power. People who are usually at the top and in charge, we don't seek to see that. In terms of, it's funny because this was written in a different voting year, right? Mm-hmm. We're in a voting year, and we're also in a time of multiple genocides.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a bank account, you have power. If you make money, you have power. I would say there's nothing individually, of course, we can do, but be vigilant on where you spend your money and who deserves your capital. Mm-hmm. And I say that because we've been in a time, right, in a hyper-consumerist place, but our cell phones, this battery in this vape that I have, batteries in that camera, batteries in electronics, all are coming from the Congo. Mm-hmm. Which, if you need a sort of understanding of what the Congo is, think of it like Wakanda, right, from Black Panther. They were trying to get the vibranium from Wakanda. That's basically, it's not fiction, right? It's not really fiction. So I'm trying to keep it light. I really am, but the work is radical because all of our liberation is tied together. And so the biggest thing I could say is that be careful where you spend your money and who gets it. Amazon shouldn't even be a thing. That's just my personal opinion. I can't tell you who to vote for. All I can say is that the history of the two-party system in this country gets us on a repeat of the same four-year sort of thing. And so perhaps, as comfortable as you feel, looking into third-party candidates, people that aren't taking money from people with blood on their hands, making sure you're vigilant and not being complicit in your own murder. Because be very clear, my favorite writer, Zora Neale Hurston, said, if you are silent about your pain, they will kill you and say you enjoyed it, okay? I say all of the things I'm saying with love. I say them with a passion. And I really hope that, you know, you make sure that when you're giving your money to a place, that they deserve it. That's what I would say, some of the things.
I echo all those sentiments. I'm gonna keep it simple and light too, because I am known to be a radical in these streets. But it's a skill to be able to hone it in, because from a psychological standpoint, you don't want to incite fear into people, right? And although we know these are troubling times that we're living in, I'm gonna keep it simple with just saying and echoing, be intentional with any and everything. There always needs to be a reason behind it. But more importantly, to to talk about the root, because it's, your question is so multi-layered, and we don't even have the time to get into it, right? That's what the forums are for. And the city council meetings, and the zoning boards, and the planning boards, Congress, all that good stuff. Things that we saw in Cadillac. Mm-hmm. But I will say, we need to start talking to each other a little bit more. Because the reality is, as it relates to this work, and Black Lives Matter was something that was super pivotal in this show, especially with the three during the podcast scene that you've seen, Alicia Garza, Patrice Cullors, Opal Tometi. There's controversy with Black Lives Matter, right? I'm currently contracted with Black Lives Matter, the Patterson branch. And the controversy within that movement in and of itself, they don't even respect, meaning the branches of the global network of Black Lives Matter, the three characters you met here, they don't even respect the global network. Because there's issues in that storyline of how Black Lives Matter was even birthed. So be intentional with your dollars is the point. In terms of talking to one another, we gotta be more strategic in having these conversations, whether it's with larger organizations or your own personal organization that you have, because the reality is the work is being done, but it's being done in silos. And there's a competitive nature to it as well. I had an earlier conversation about competitive nature within the work that needs to be done in our communities. Because it always comes back to funding, where Ashley mentioned a lot of y'all had questions on how do we scale this? Where can we see more? Mm-hmm. Our country is in a state of running out of money. We run on credit in America. Mm-hmm. And we're in debt. And we're the ones that's paying for it, though, right? And we're losing the middle class. Let me get off my soapbox now, too. Reeling it in to say, be intentional, start having conversations, and even though they're not advertising the meetings, find them. Just like the character Rachel said, do your own research. You got to, because if you don't, your quote from Zora Neale Hurston, it rings true for everybody. Because race is diminishing and it's turning into class. We learned that from COVID quarantine. Mm-hmm. Don't miss the moment, I'm done.
And accessibility and disability.
Yes.
Just in terms of like intersectionality, there are so many able-bodied people who are being disabled by COVID. One in four people have long COVID. If you've had COVID, one in four of those people have long COVID, meaning they're going to live their life with those effects. And so it's also about, and it's going to sound so hypocritical because I don't have a mask on, but masking.
Because you live in them, right?
Right. Masking and thinking. It's very easy to think to be ableistic and just not thinking accessible, but in terms of even this, if someone deaf had came, I would have been so embarrassed because, I didn't even think about that. But if you have to be able to have space for everyone and not feel like this is an extra. It's not extra, it's equity. You gotta meet people where they're at. Some people need this much, some people need this much.
Right.
And so it's, it's about like more empathy, where something Cat Williams said in that very spicy interview, but was this world runs off of the love of a very few people. Like this world loves off of the love of very, very few people. And that resonated with me. So in terms of everything, empathy, even if that person maybe like you don't feel like they deserve it, try to put yourself in their shoes, which just sounds so third grade, but like we've lost that.
We gotta go back to the basics.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, they just taught people how to rewash their hands in 20. They taught the whole world
how
to
wash
their hands in 2020. Like, so back to the basics for sure.
Thank you so much, y'all, for coming and joining us for this talk.